Well, this is what I was saying about the brain-computer interfaces. I think that's the real, that's even bigger frontier than synthetic biology or genetic engineering, because computers are really useful for things, robots are very useful for things.
Yeah.
Human beings are just going to sort of blend in. It's not like we're going to have AI and super healthy humans, it's we're going to just have everywhere on that spectrum.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking as well. There's going to be some sort of a symbiotic thing, like a chip or...
Lots of people are working on it. Elon Musk has a little company that no one knows about.
Well, they do now.
Yeah. Well, people know about it if they care, but it's not like one of his famous ones, right?
Right.
To implant neural lace, right? To put something in your body that reads your brain. Yeah, and improve you. Yeah.
Neural lace.
You won't need your phone anymore.
Wow.
I mean, companies that want to make money in the short term are building these non-surgical, non-invasive things where you like wear something on the front of your head, right?
Yeah.
Or a cap or something like that, which can detect frequencies of vibrations in your brain. And you can, it's very primitive, but you can move things around. You can control drones, right, with your brain without touching anything. But the thing to imagine in the far out science fiction scenario is cracking open your skull, inserting some electrodes in there, closing it back up, and now you're part of the super internet without doing anything more than closing your eyes. You know, I think, and this is just a kind of uninformed belief, but I suspect that the human brain is pretty optimized for what it tries to do. I think that rather than improving the brain or stimulating it, the way forward is to augment it, like hook it up to calculators and internet and whatever. You know, one thing that I don't see talked about very much, but I think will be a real game changer. You know, we talk about phones as if we're carrying around phones, but we don't mostly use our phones to talk to people on the phone, right? We check the email, check the internet, and we take pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Once you really have, and again, it might not be possible, but if you really had a direct connection between your brain and the internet, your eyeballs are a video camera. Everything you see, you can record and store somewhere, right? So, and you can lend them to other people, or people can subpoena them or whatever. Like, there's literally no place in the world that human eyeballs aren't looking at that would not be subject to later inspection. And that is weird and scary and bad. And I think that there is a short-term versus long-term question here, right? Like, even if what I said is a long-term truth, on the short-term, improving our thinking skills in direct ways with stimulation or whatever sounds, you know, pretty good. But maybe you can just do that through beta blockers or some drugs or something like that. Like, I think that that's another thing very plausible, that we'll have safe, super efficient drugs someone can take in over the next 6 hours. They're way clearer thinkers than they were before. There's a lot of talk in, you know, the AI existential risk community, like worrying about artificial intelligence, about value alignment, like making sure that the AIs value the same things that we do, like our existence, for example, right?
Yeah.
But I think a little bit, at least what I hear, and I'm not an expert, but what I hear, it seems a little bit off the mark because they're talking about what to program into the AI. But if it's in any sense really an AI, it can reprogram itself, right?
Yeah.
Like, you can change your mind as a human being. You can change your values. You can change your motivations. Artificial intelligences should be able to do the same thing. And in fact, they better be able to do that if they're going to be truly intelligent. If they're going to mimic what a human being can do, it can't be something where we program them to just do a task, because that's not intelligent, right? So if that happens, yeah, then, you know, who knows what they're going to eventually be motivated to do, if anything. Like you said, like, what is their motivation even to do anything at all, or even to exist? These are hard things to even extrapolate because they're so far beyond our experience. But I do think that we're opening up doors that we never have before.
Right.
Between genetic modifications of human beings, artificial intelligence, brain-computer interfaces. We don't have the experience or the capacity to really even ask the right questions about these things. When people invented the internet, they weren't sure what they were going to do with it. And I think that the same thing is true when if we can imagine blending the barrier between our biological existence and some virtual existence, we don't even know what questions to ask about that. I think that it's going to change. Like, if we combine this idea of, you know, interfacing with computers, with this idea of drones doing some drudgery work, with this idea of giving people a basic income, mm-hmm. everyone is just going to sit in their rooms and write on their tumblers all day. That's going to be the future.
I don't think they're going to be writing anymore. I think there's a real possibility that we're going to create virtual reality that's indistinguishable from regular reality, and people are going to live in there like Ready Player One.
Well, it'll be better.
That kind of thing.
I think that the big flaw to me in things like Tron or Ready Player One is that they make the virtual reality look too much like the real reality. Mm-hmm. There's no reason why virtual reality has to have gravity.
Right.
There's
right.
no reason why it has to be three-dimensional. There's no yeah, reason why, you know, true. You have any limit on how strong you are or how fast you are or anything yeah. like that. Like, there's no reason why you have to have only one body. I mean, there's a million different ways in which it could be very, very different.
Well, it also could be implemented with something like the tank, the float tank that we were talking yeah. about earlier. I mean, you could climb into that float tank with some sort of apparatus, hook these gloves on, put this helmet over, and literally not be subject to the whims of gravity. You can't even feel it.
Yep.
The effects of gravity will be inconsequential because you will feel like you're floating, and then from there you'll be able to fly around and do all sorts of
yeah, I think
stuff.
Like this weird period between, you know, the year 1900 and 2000 or 2100 or whatever it's going to be, it'll be a weird transitional period in human history where we had invented technology and not really put it to work yet. And there might be some equilibrium that we reach in 100 or 200 years where the whole mode of life is utterly different than what it is now.
If you could put priorities in terms of like what you think people should concentrate on first when in regards to this kind of stuff, what do you think those would be? Like, if someone said, Sean, you're a super smart dude, let's get on the ball here and figure out what direction should we take this in?
I mean, what I do for a living is more like foundational, what are the laws of physics kind of things,
yeah.
right? So I'm not the person to speculate on this
but
stuff.
Who is?
But, well, I think this is why I said earlier, like, I think we should be talking to each other, because nobody is. No one person is, right? Like, that's why we need to have people from different areas of expertise talk about each other's areas, if mm-hmm. only then to be corrected, right? But, you know, to be open to that dialogue. So I think that, for example, an enormous amount of effort has been put into nanotechnology, building tiny little machines. I suspect that mostly the real advances there are not going to be in nanotechnology, but in synthetic biology, where you take bacteria or multicellular organisms that already exist and adapt them for your purposes, make them do whatever you want, because biology has already solved a lot of the problems that technology is still struggling to figure out.
So the concept of nanotechnology is you're going to take like almost like a cell-sized machine,
right?
And many of them are going to go into your body and find areas that are damaged or that are
or
problems.
Do whatever. Yeah, yeah. There's a professor at Caltech who gave a talk a few months ago about she builds robots out of DNA. So these little DNA robots can go in, and right now they're at the level where what they can do is sort things. So like if they have molecule 1 and molecule 2 scattered across some surface, this little DNA robot will go in and move all molecule 1 to the left, all of molecule 2 to the right. And so she says that's the beginning. Like in the future, you'll have your little DNA box and you'll say, you know, I'm allergic to tomatoes. And then it will invent a little machine that will run through your body and fix your allergy to tomatoes. Right, whoa. You don't need that anymore.
Whoa, with a machine,
with a DNA robot. So it's literally so. Why DNA? Because you think of DNA as carrying the genetic code, but DNA is a wonderful molecule because it is relatively stable. But it's not just a crystal, right? It's not just doing the same thing over and over again. So it contains information, and it can adapt. It can you know hold on and grab on to certain things and let go and do things. So DNA is a wonderful testing ground for building little really really tiny things in your body that will change who you are.